sorry for inconvenience for the last time. So here I am. I'm presenting about automating AWS infra using Ansible Tower. Let's go with next slide. Okay, who am I? I'm an engineering grad, just graduated 2 months before. RSCSA, you can call it. Mozilla contributor, Otaku. I think Otaku, you don't know about Otaku. Otaku, which is a Japanese term, which is used to describe people who are passionate about animes and manga, reading manga magazines. I'm Ansible support engineer at Red Hat Pune. It's been 5 months I'm being with Red Hat. So next month I'll be getting permanent into Red Hat. Let's hope. So yeah, today's agenda. So we can read it. Why Ansible and Ansible Tower? Why to automate AWS, its features and some benefits of it? Automating AWS using Ansible Tower a demo. Let's see if we get time. So, okay. So let's talk about Ansible first. So Ansible, you can call it simple. You can call it same time powerful. Ansible is simple, powerful automation language. With Ansible, you can accelerate your automation for application deployment, for configuration management, and for orchestration without the need to install the agent on your managed system to manage softwares. Okay. And Ansible Tower is a enterprise framework which is based upon Ansible automation to control and secure your services. And managing every application you are deploying on cloud. So these are some questions I found that many of corporate people or organization companies are facing nowadays. So questions are like, how can we control cloud deployments? How does DevOps works in the cloud? Will my development be secure? How can we migrate existing app to the cloud? So these are the many questions and I got only one answer for it. So it sounds cool, right? So let's go for the answer. Answer is not showing. So, man. Oh man. Where am I? Content. So, okay guys, so the answer is automate with Ansible. Yeah, that is the answer. So yeah. sorry. Thank you. Yeah, so to automate AWS with Ansible, you got 100 modules in Ansible. So using that module, we can support you to automate your AWS infra using Ansible Tower. So let's go into next slide. Okay, these are some benefits with AWS. Okay, so benefits are like, consider you want to deploy your application to the cloud. Consider you are deploying your application on AWS and you have deployed so many applications over there. And right now, the main thing is that how to keep a track of it. Like you have deployed thousands of applications and you have to know at which application I have deployed and how to keep a track. So Ansible has some dynamic inventory synchronization. So by which you can synchronize all your hosts present in your AWS infra. So in your playbook in your system, so you can get to know about how many applications do you have over there. And another benefit is like, consider your CIO told you to migrate your whole database or workload onto AWS, and and what you'll do that time? If you are using Ansible Tower, you don't have to do much thing. You just have to use same playbook to automate the things to migrate the whole data to Ansible infrastructure. Yeah. It is showing now. Okay. So safely automating at the speed of business, let's consider when your organization is small and you got only 2 people or 3 people working on AWS. So it seems good, right? You got only 2 people, you have to manage 2 people on the AWS. What if there are so many 10 or thousands of people working on AWS? 19 seconds later. AWS. And so what you can do, you can use Ansible Tower. It has RBAC, which is role-based control access policy. So by using it, you can give roles to specific users. And yeah, that's it. So this is me, Saurabh Thakre, an Ansible support engineer at Pune. So if you have any queries about it, you can meet me offline. I have some swags for you. So yeah, you'll definitely meet me. Thank you, guys.
Continuous integration with Drone. I'm Vivek Swaminath. I'm a senior engineer at Target. If you have a real quick thing, if you have any questions around Drone, please do feel free to post to my Twitter handle. It's over there. We are really excited about using Drone at Target. It's been trending at Drone. And well, what is Drone? Drone is an open source CI/CD software that is written completely in Golang. And it's available as a Docker image. It's hardly 30 MB in size. The best part is that Drone Cloud is free of cost for the open source community, and you have a licensed version as well. So based on your needs, you can choose what kind of license you need. And if you see the GIF over there, it's kind of containers everywhere. That's what exactly Drone is. The Drone master is a container. The Drone agent is a container. The plugins in Drone as well are containers. Drone was first released in the year 2014 under the Apache license. And the founder is Brad Rajinsky. There's a very interesting podcast in Google that says why Brad thought of the idea of having Drone. Drone has a master agent architecture in the sense that master exposes the APIs, and it also shows up the UI. And the agent is a worker node which connects to the master. It takes in the job specs, executes them, and returns the results back to the Drone master. Of course, there you can easily spin off Drone in a Kubernetes cluster using Helm charts. Drone is integrated with various version control systems such as GOX, Bitbucket, GitHub. And there are a lot of plugins available around Drone. Say, for instance, you want to use, you want to push your Docker images to a Docker registry, you use the Docker plugin. Or suppose you want to post the success status or your failure status to Slack, you use a Slack plugin, and so on and so forth. There are a lot of plugins available in the plugins repository. And Drone really empowers the developers in the sense that you can write your own custom plugins in various languages such as Golang, Python, etc. This is a Drone spec setup that is very simple. If you want to immediately have Drone set up in your Mac or laptop, you can easily do it with a Docker Compose.yaml file. The first thing is you have to have a GOX repo or any kind of Git repo, and the Drone server, which is dependent on the Git repo. So there's a flag which mentions that depends on GOX that is there. And then also Drone GOX, Drone underscore GOX equal to true. That is what you need to mention. So in case you're using GitHub, you mention as Drone underscore GitHub equal to true. And there's a Drone secret variable that should be same as what is there that is mentioned in the Drone agent. So definitely after that, the Drone agent is there, which is again dependent on the Drone server. So when okay, the if you see a Drone host over there variable, you have to just set that in the .env file, and when you just do a Docker compose up -d, a Drone is up and running. This is an example use case where a developer pushes his commits to the GitHub, and there's a webhook that is created in Drone that triggers the Drone builds. And then you have containers spun off, wherein you can do a functional test case, and you can use custom plugins like a Packer plugin that will create your images, a cloud image, and you can use Drone plugins such as Drone Terraform or maybe, I mean, use a Boto to spin off an instance in the cloud environment. This is how a sample GitHub repo looks like, and you need to have .drone.yaml at the root of the GitHub project. This is required so that the drone is running. And this is a drone.yaml file, so it's so whenever I mean the drone actually clones the GitHub the project, and if you specify a workspace, it clones it over there, so it's available over there. You don't have to explicitly specify the Git plugin over there. And then this is a pipeline, which is a series of steps that execute in a certain order. So for instance, I have a test that I need to run for my Golang, and I specify the event as a pull request. And again, a constraint as the branch should be master. So what happens is whenever a developer raises a pull request, drone test part gets executed. And since there's no constraint in the build part, it executes for all the events, whether it's a push or event or a tag or a pull request. And in post build, I've again put a constraint such as event push under a branch master, so it executes the binary. And notification is whether, again, there's a Slack plugin, a drone Slack plugin. So for status that is success or failure, it will notify to the Slack handle. This is what typically a drone UI looks like. If you synchronize over there, all your repos are reflected over there, and you just need to enable the toggle button that is over there so that the webhook is enabled. So that's all, I mean, about drone, and you have a success builds over there. All green builds are all successful ones. I wish I had time, I could have shown a quick demo, but that's fine. Thanks a lot. If you have any questions, again, please do tweet me at my Twitter handle. Thanks.
Today, I just want to talk about the relationship between DevOps and Agile, and whether they are really made for each other. Okay. So this is a common representation of DevOps, the infinite cycles, and Agile circles. And first of all, I would like to thank Sheraton team for architecting this ceiling hanging lights as a it resonates like DevOps circles and making a true DevOps team here, okay? So I don't want to talk about much because most of the people knows what is DevOps and Agile. So why we are talking about the partnership between the DevOps and Agile? If you see at in the simple terms, DevOps is like bridging the gap between the development team and the operations team. So whereas Agile actually software development process where we are continually monitoring the business value. So we are, we are doing retrospection and we are making up the customer trends. But if you see at whole picture, there is a still gap between the business values and the DevOps, community. So when you combine all together as a partnership, we can have a much valued quality software continuously. Okay. And what is this? What are the benefits we'll get? By doing this engagement. So first of all, we can deliver faster, okay? And it allows us to, time to market faster, because otherwise when you are there in the market already outdated, those kind of situations we can avoid by doing this, partnership. And always it's a customer focusing. And why people are not adapting both the worlds, okay? So there are a lot of challenges. Okay, first major challenge is companies, they don't want to interact their business. They want to continue their business as usual. And there are still, there are organizations want to adopt the DevOps, they say there is a lot of skill shortage. And also, when you are working at distributed systems, there are much more complex problems are there. And the companies don't want to change, okay? They just want to run. And there are compliance standards, regulatory problems, and there are no clear KPIs. And when you are talking about diversity adoption, it's about teams, okay? Communication teams, between the different teams. It's about departmental mentality. Okay, so how to solve these problems? I want to go to basics. Just keep comms, okay? That's a simple solution we want to propose, okay? So somebody in the keynote asking, is just, want to start a DevOps career, and he want to know what is the right tool he can learn, because there are a lot of tools, okay? I was confused, and he just want to know what are the practices, what is, how you, you become a DevOps professional and all. So it's not about the tools, it's not about learning the tools, or it's not about the practices, it's all about the cultural shift, okay? So why we are stressing this, and we can sense from the, Patrick keynote that we are missing the basics. So it's all about, if there are professionals, they want to try, but if management is not allowing us, so then it's no use, right? And also, their people mentality has to change by hearts and minds. They have to embrace the change. And it's not about hiring the highly skilled person. It's you can always, train the people within the organization and you can upgrade themselves. So people has to change. So that is the main thing needed when you're adopting the new technology, new processes actually. Okay, this is a cultural shift we are talking about. And automations, we all agree that still organizations, they have less than 50% automation. So it's pictorial representation. So when you are doing a manual process, you're putting all your energy into this and you have less scope for innovation and room for trying out the new things. So automate everything, testing, deployment, infrastructure, everything. So that you can have a time to do a good things innovation. So I also want to add a lean methodology, because always there is a talk about camps only, but I want to make it as comms, because we observed that there is a lot of waste things are going on. Let us say there are a lot of in order to simplify this, we have just acronym that's downtime, and you can just do that waste management thing and lean and be fit. And this is a metrics we want to always measureize everything and keep focus on improving the things and measure you're going the right direction. So this is about culture and sharing. These are the two fundamental principles we are neglecting so far, and that's why I'm stressing on here. It's all about sharing, open culture, collaboration, and especially in a distributed system. And it's like helping each other thrive. And by the way, these guys are doing Scrum in the Sky. So it's when you are doing a fundamental strong, and you have it's all about. It's not about engagement and all. It's not about triangular. It's not about. It's a continuous relationship and keep business growing. Okay. Okay, that's all I have, and I just want to test the basics who are new to DevOps and Agile methodologies, and just talk about these topics. So if you have any queries, just meet us and FI booth, and we can have more fun. Thank you.
Next up, we have Prithvi Raj Aluri, and this topic is human-centered DevOps from F5 Networks. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. I request everyone to please stick to time limits, like we are in a tight schedule here. So.
Sure. And I would start with appreciating Abhinav. When I was, an intern, I didn't have the courage to face the stage, but yeah. And whatever happened to Abhinav today, that's a typical day of many of our lives. So you're going to start my slide time now. Yeah. Hi all. Good evening. So I'm I'm a manager product development at FI Networks. So today I'm going to speak about human side of DevOps. So what I really mean is, how is it affecting us as engineers? So what are we doing? How is DevOps, or probably what DevOps means to us as humans who are, unfortunately in the, in this big loop of, escalations, downtimes, let me explain you more. So what is DevOps and how is that to do with humans and machines? So typically machines are good with algorithms and we are not. So machines are good with, relating data, we are not. So, and we are bad at fabricating data. We are bad at detecting enormous data, patterns in enormous data. So the combination of both is really what DevOps is. So what is DevOps? DevOps is nothing but DevOps and computers. So without computers, DevOps is not there, and without ops, there's no dev, and without dev, there's no ops. A business runs with dev and ops together. So is DevOps really helping in creating a better mankind? So what do you think? DevOps engineers, how many of you are proud to be a DevOps engineer? Okay. Sure. We are not doing anything great. what DevOps is doing really is, it is helping business. It is not doing anything unique. We are not doing anything great, right? So let me just keep this thought here and, explain my experience of what DevOps is. DevOps, I get calls from, people saying, boss, we have an opening for NoOps. I said, what? What do you mean by NoOps? We're looking for DevOps engineers who can also do NoOps. Okay, then why do you need ops? So that's one side of the story. The other side, I mentor people and people call me, said, boss, I want to get into DevOps. I said, okay, what are you doing? I'm a QA engineer. So do you write test cases? Yes, I do. Then you are a DevOps guy already. If you're writing a test cases, you're automating something. You're really doing something different. And you're automating the stuff that you normally do at your routine. That is DevOps. And what DevOps is really doing is it is helping us we create engineers, both ops engineers, dev engineers, be on the same page. So it's not like how it used to be 10 years back. The Linux sysadmin guys are thinking in one direction. The QA guy's job is just to, give some bugs. Developers, they just develop something. No, but DevOps is doing something different. DevOps is just helping, everyone work towards a single objective, which is really helping the business. And DevOps is also helping in, DevOps is really helping in building, build and ship products faster with the CI/CDs and all the pipelines. It's also really creating a real cross-functional teams. I never thought I can code. I was always a Linux admin. But the word DevOps forced me to learn coding. Now I'm a developer. DevOps is bringing the best of co-located agile teams. That is making me tense. DevOps is helping organization appreciate failures. So in the current age, in the current era that we are working on, failures should be appreciated. Because the tool sets that we are working on, we are failing every day. There's a new tool coming in market, new tools coming in market. If your organization is not appreciating failures, then you're not growing. So DevOps is really helping in that space because the world is understanding what DevOps is. And if you're not failing and if your organization is not appreciating failures, you're not growing in this space. So this is a quote I like. It's a DevOps journey that teaches you a lot about your organization's strengths and weakness. The DevOps is not going to solve your problem, but the way you deal with DevOps, the way you approach it, the way you onboard tools, that will give you a lot of insights of what's happening with your system, what can you do better, right? And finally, a quote. So these are all the tools, but the statement, tools simplify process but don't solve problems, but the process built around the tools will. So the point of this is the thousands of tools, hundreds of methodologies, but what you really do as a DevOps team is you do iterations of multiple tools, you try different methodologies, there's one process or there's one tool that really fits your requirement. That's where you need to put your time on. And there's no wrong, you know, looking at 100 tools, but there's one tool and you keep searching for that tool. Once you get that tool, the problem is solved. And thanks. Okay. Stop there. Yeah, I'm Prithvi, and we'll be at the FI booth, and we'll be happy to, you know, catch up, share our experiences, share our failures, share our success. I'll be at the FI booth. Please catch up. Thanks.
Thank you, Prithvi.